Hello and welcome to your library at home. My name is Sam Hagen and I'm part of the library's public programming team. I'd like to begin today by acknowledging that we meet on country. I live and work on Gadigal land and I'd like to take this opportunity to pay my respects to elders past, present and especially emerging. I also extend that respect to any Aboriginal Australians who are joining with us today. Welcome to all of you, and welcome to today's author talk. We've got two fabulous speakers today, the author of Law in War, Associate Professor Catherine Bond, and the library's own Elise Edmonds. But before I introduce Elise, who will introduce Catherine, I just wanted to let you know about another event coming up which you may be interested in. This Friday, so in a couple of days' time, our library curator, Maggie Patton, will be presenting a fascinating curator talk on books that are printed from 1456 to 1500. They're called Incunabula, that's their name, and it translates to From the Cradle. So the library is lucky enough to hold over 200 of these really precious items, and Maggie's going to be sharing some examples with you from 1 p.m. on Friday. So do jump online, go to www.sl.nsw.gov.au/events. You can go there after this talk and you can book your spot for Maggie's talk. But today, back to the business of the day, I'm so pleased to once again be able to introduce my colleague, Elise Edmonds. Elise is a senior curator at the library. In 2009, she received a staff fellowship to research and scope the library's First World War collections. And this led her to curating several exhibitions, highlighting the library's nationally significant First World War collection items. One of the exhibitions was called Life Interrupted, and it was full of personal diaries from World War I. I was lucky enough to be able to program for that exhibition, and it was absolutely stunning. She did an amazing job. In 2014, she did that. And then she did another exhibition called Colour in Darkness, which is from the First World War, and that was in 2016. I'm sure there are remnants of both those exhibitions online if you'd like to go and have a look at some of the library's collections. I particularly recommend the diaries. They're fascinating, beautiful, heartbreaking, joyful. All of the human emotions are in there, and some of them are digitised. But I will now hand over to Elise. I will see you at the end to moderate a Q&A. But for the meantime, Elise, are you with us? There you are. Hi, I'm going to leave you to it and I'll see you again at the end.
Thanks, Sam. I'm Elise. I'm here at the State Library today on site, and the State Library sits upon Gadigal lands, and I would like to acknowledge and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging, and pay my respects to any Aboriginal people with us today. Welcome. Well, I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Catherine Bond. She is an Associate Professor in the Faculty of Law at the University of New South Wales. She teaches and researches primarily in intellectual property law with a focus on the intersection between law and history. She's published in a range of leading Australian and international journals across issues including government ownership of copyright and Charles Bean's official history of Australia in the war, 1914 to 1918. Also in regards to plain packaging of tobacco products and in the introduction of a patent system in the Game of Thrones world of Westeros, which is fascinating. Her first book was called Anzac, The Landing, The Legend, The Law, which analysed the regulation of the word Anzac in Australia and internationally from 1916 through to today. So that work, she says, inspired her second book, which is called Law in War, Freedom and Restriction in Australia During the Great War, which is published very recently by New South Publishing in April of this year. So I would like to welcome Catherine.
Hi everyone. Hi Elise. Thank you so much for having me along today.
You're welcome. It's great to see you. Congratulations on publishing the book.
Thank you so much. And it's a real pleasure to be doing a talk with the State Library. I think any writer in New South Wales can't possibly publish a book without utilising the collections of the State Library, and many of the images and materials that I used in the book come from the State Library too. So this is a particularly special event for me.
Excellent, excellent. So I guess what we'll, my thinking behind this session is we'll talk. I've devised some questions for Catherine. So I think we'll plan to discuss for about 45 minutes and we'll leave about 15 minutes at the end for questions. So we'll aim to stop at around 1:15 and people will be invited to click on the Q&A button down the bottom of the screen and send questions, and Sam will moderate those at the end. So Catherine, you say in your little biographical spiel that you got thinking about your second book when you were working on your first book. So can you talk about what you were hoping to set out in this book and what was your research interest?
So when I was working on the Anzac book, I came across this big collection of letters held by the National Archives in Canberra, and it was letters written by members of families of men who were serving overseas, and they were writing to the Prime Minister, the Attorney General, to get permission to use the word Anzac. And they wrote these just very heartfelt letters. And it made me realise that in the majority of their cases, this was probably the first time that they'd had any kind of engagement with a big institution like the government or with law. And as I continued work on that book, I realised there were kind of two separate strands. The first was that there were all these personal stories that really hadn't been explored, but also all of these elements of law that hadn't been explored as well. We've got such a rich and varied collection of works written about the Great War in Australia, but none that really explored law, or more specifically the legal experiences of individuals during that period. And in the Anzac book, I mentioned quite a few of the characters, the people who I write about, who subsequently became chapters in Law and War. And it's funny, I was reflecting today the fact that at the start of 2017 was when I decided that I would start writing this book. And I was working on another very doctrinal journal article at the time, and I knew I didn't want this to be anything like that. And I wrote down on a post-it, actually, almost exactly the order of the chapters. I knew the people that I wanted to write about generally from the start. But then there were some more. I knew that I wanted to be able to tell the stories of Indigenous or other Australians who may have been unable to serve, even though they wished to do so. And so that was the jumping off point for the book, as it was published in April.
So you indeed, you really focus on the personal stories of people in Australia who were impacted in various ways by this legislation that was passed. So it's quite a fascinating book because you can, learn about these individuals and how the law was impacted on them in particular. So it's 13, I think, isn't it? Individuals you write about.
Yeah.
So I thought initially it's always helpful to start with some context, historical context. Can you talk about the main key pieces of legislation that were passed in that early period of the war in 1914? And yeah, I guess the big laws that were passed and how that impacted on people in Australia.
Yeah, so I describe it as a kind of trinity of legislation that was passed in the early months of the war. And this was a kind of very, there was a lot going on in Australia during those first few months of the war, from kind of August to October, November, when these pieces of legislation ultimately became law in Australia. So war was declared in August. There was a federal election in September 1914. So the government actually changed hands to the Labor government led by Andrew Fisher during that period. And then in around October, November 1914, that's when this trinity of legislation that subsequently came through Parliament. So the first was the Crimes Act, and this wasn't actually a piece of war-related legislation. And the Crimes Act 1914 is actually in force still today. It is the main piece of legislation that sets up federal criminal law in Australia. And it was just a sheer coincidence of timing that the Fisher government was the one, this bill had been passed around a bit, the Fisher government was the one that actually passed it, but it had a number of provisions that were very usefully related to the war, for example, around treason. The next piece of legislation was the Trading with the Enemy Act, and this provided, this put into legislation offences around, as the name suggested, trading with the enemy. So with the outbreak of war, governments have to start thinking about, okay, we have, Australia was a major exporter country. We have a lot of companies in Australia that either are owned by or have shareholders or boards comprised of individuals who are now our enemy. How exactly do we deal with this? So they created the Trading with the Enemy Act, and that was supplemented with other commerce-related legislation or commerce-related acts as the kind of first 6 months to year of the war progressed. Mm-hmm. However, the big one was the War Precautions Act. And in the book, I write how this act has almost taken on a kind of infamy. If you've heard of any piece of legislation related to World War I, to the First World War, you've heard of the War Precautions Act. What this act did was it created a framework which deemed significant power in the Governor General at the time, but more specifically, the executive, so the ministers, the Attorney General, William Hughes, to make regulations. So the Act itself was not particularly long. It simply created a range of areas where the Governor General could make regulations and imposed different fines for breaches of particular offences. So it wasn't anything, when you look at it, you don't think that this is a particularly significant act. But as the war progressed, this became the major piece of legislation that the government at the time used to pin a whole range of measures on and created these measures underneath this act. Because they were regulations, these provisions, though the regulations didn't need to go through Parliament. So you have just the executive branch overseeing the creation of regulations. If they were concerned something might not be covered by the law, then they went back to Parliament. But for the most part, they were just simply creating law via regulations. This act was actually inspired or based on originally the British Act, the Defence of the Realm Act. But there's a wonderful quote that I use in the book, this idea that Billy Hughes, our Attorney General, and then the Prime Minister became more British than the Britishers. He went after the war. He went after his prosecution of the war using every tool available, and this included the law and his beloved War Precautions Act.
So, yes, Billy Hughes is a real singular character in Australian history.
Yes.
So when that federal election happened and Labor got in 1914, yep. So he was then the Attorney General.
Yes.
And then, of course, he becomes Prime Minister later on. So it's Billy Hughes that is the prime writer of these regulations.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so actually I have a little show and tell here. So this is my copy of the Billy book, which is in numerous copies are held at the State Library. This was a series of cartoons created, published by David Lowe in 1918. And it's just fascinating. It really shows what a divisive character Hughes really was. He had been re-elected as Prime Minister by this point, but still the cartoons in here do not suggest a man or portray a man that you would not believe would be so integral to so respected and integral to Australia's war effort. Yeah. So he, as Attorney General, was responsible for the broad oversight of the laws. And it was his secretary, then Solicitor General, Robert Garran, who did a lot of the drafting of the laws themselves.
Mm. And it's really interesting that you said that the Australian government, or Hughes and Garran, really went beyond the British, the similar British laws.
Yep.
It's really interesting, isn't it, to think about what was it in Australia that really, what were they particularly fearful of, that they thought that Australian society was in danger of?
And I mean, it was very common at that time. And from the outset of the war, this was reflected in law. It was very common that there were fears of German infiltration or enemy infiltration in the community. But certainly, I mean, it's obviously we can look back in retrospect now and see that was never an issue. But even at the time, I would say the measures introduced certainly went above and beyond what we might consider a proportionate response to that fear within the community.
Yeah, so I think we'll go in, and certainly as you did in the book, you go in and look at how individuals were impacted by these. So I guess one of the big things that came out of particularly the War Precautions Act that I'm at least familiar with is the laws and regulations that were passed that impacted upon people of German heritage living in Australia.
Yeah.
So can you sort of talk broadly about how those people were impacted? And often they were people who had been living in Australia, residing in Australia for several decades. Many had married Australian women, had Australian children, had settled. So it's a fascinating thing that,
Yeah, and this is one of the things, this treatment was one of the things that really bothered me about when I was writing the book, and it led to me to that broader reflection of the fact that, you know, when you build a life in a country, whether you're born in that country or come from overseas, it's almost as though you enter into a contract with that country, you pay your taxes, you settle in the community, and there was just something so unsettling about what happened to individuals of German heritage during this period.
And so Austro-Hungarian, I guess, as well.
Yes, Austro-Hungarian and Turkish. I often say German. The majority of enemy aliens or those considered enemies were German during this period. The 1911 census established that there were just under 30,000 individuals who had been born in Germany at the time in Australia. And these individuals, but there also were individuals who had German parents and others of German heritage. So it's not really a representative figure. These individuals subsequently became a part of one of two categories. The first category was enemy aliens, those who lived in Australia, were resident here, but still maintained their German citizenship and hadn't sought to become a naturalised British subject. Then on the other hand, there were naturalised subjects of enemy origin. And they were treated a little bit differently to begin with, but then that distinction became even narrower. And actually, by around 1916, any alien, whether a friendly alien, like a person from the United States, everyone was treated the same. So with respect to enemy aliens, from the outset, the first week of the war, they were required to register their name and details with their local police. If they were a member of the armed forces, an enemy armed forces, or a reservist, they could be arrested. Most often than not, they would be paroled. However, they could also be arrested and then subsequently interned in one of the internment camps set up in most of the states and territories in Australia, if they were deemed to be dangerous to the community or if they were found in possession of a firearm, for example. Those were the early provisions, and they make sense to a certain degree. Then the war continues, and particularly around the time we get to the Gallipoli period. So it's like I take a deep breath and then I just come forward with this list. So they couldn't, as the war progressed, they couldn't leave the Commonwealth without permission. If they moved, they needed to re-register their details. If they were sacked by their employer because of their heritage, they could not take that employer to court. They couldn't possess firearms or other weapons. They couldn't publish or distribute newspapers in a language that well, in the language of a country currently in a state of war with the king. They couldn't change their names. As the war progressed, these naturalised British subjects who had been born overseas also came under these provisions. Mm. And naturalised British subjects could also be interned if they were considered to be disaffected or disloyal. Mm. As the war progressed, those naturalised subjects of enemy origin also lost the right to vote. Mm. What could they do? They could be deported. They could be interned. The government would provide money to their families if they were destitute. If they were destitute and couldn't find employment, they could also voluntarily intern themselves. So it's every time I look through those provisions, on the one hand, as I said, you can understand why certain measures were put in place. Mm-hmm. There was such a fear in the community at the time, but how devastating it must have been for individuals who had lived in this country for decades to lose their ability to vote, to have a say. Mm-hmm. And that happened just before the federal election in 1917. So mm-hmm. to lose their liberty by being interned and lose their right to vote, mm-hmm. to have a say in who runs the country.
Yeah. And, you know, it's you kind of wonder how much Australians knew about the about it as well. I suppose if you knew someone on your street or you were friends or, you know, you would be aware, but you kind of wonder what the extent of the understanding.
Yeah. Look, I think there was a general community understanding. I mean, one of the reasons why whole situation, this whole legal situation was so successful was because it was supported by the community. Mm. People dobbed in their neighbours. Just as now during the current pandemic, people are being encouraged to report behaviour that goes against public health orders. Mm. People were encouraged to dob in their neighbours. And in the book, for example, I mention a baker, George Hass, who changed his name. He was actually dobbed in by one of his neighbours and investigated by the policeman I talk about in the book, Frederick Sickerdick.
Mm. Well, yes, I wanted to come to him because he's a fascinating character. Yeah. He's one of the first people that you look at. Mm. And he's fascinating because he's a man from South Australia who is from German heritage himself.
Yeah. Yeah.
And had obviously the language. He had German language. So obviously he wasn't interned, I think because he was a couple of generations Australian-born, but he was a police officer and he became very successful at what, arresting?
Essentially.
Very successful at arresting
people. War effort at a local level, yeah. So Sickerdick's grandfather, Johann, had emigrated from Germany in the early... the early 19th century. Sickerdick's father, the family settled in Lobethal in South Australia. That's where Sickerdick himself was born. He was born either Wilhelm Friedrich or Friedrich Wilhelm. And during the course of the war, I can't identify when, he changed his name to the anglicised Frederick William Sickerdick. So he left South Australia. He moved to Victoria and became a police officer in 1911. And he was one of three state police officers who were brought in. They weren't officially hired in any capacity by the Department of Defence, but they came into work with the intelligence section of the general staff. And state police forces were really important during this period because that on the ground work, there was no Commonwealth Police Force at this time, that on the ground work, dealing with local Germans or individuals publishing newspapers or pamphlets mm-hmm. that they shouldn't be, all of that fell to the state police forces working in conjunction with these federal departments. So Sikadik was one of three police officers recruited in the early stages of the war to do this work, and he was incredibly invaluable for the government. So the fact that he spoke German meant that he could assist in a whole range of matters relating to German-speaking individuals, whether it was an individual who had failed to register or had changed their name. In one case, he and his partner later in the war were fired at by a woman who, when they were trying to identify if there was an enemy alien resident in a house. So he certainly had a very interesting career, but he's an interesting character, and I have always thought of him as just this very stalwart policeman. And I never really saw, or I didn't think a lot about, the more nefarious aspects of what he was doing. He clearly was a man who believed in justice and the rule of law. And this was how he established that. But he was very good at what he did. And that was a problem for a lot of people during this time. So he actually would, for a number of years of the war, he received bonuses because he was so successful in arrests and resulting fines and prosecutions, that for a number of years of the war, he actually received bonuses purely because of of about $5,000 today, purely because of simply how good he was at persecuting the local law and war effort.
Yeah, amazing. And so when these people were interned, the library has got some amazing collections of original material produced by internees, particularly at Holsworthy near Liverpool, but also in some of the other states' intern camps, and including some beautiful photographs. We exhibited them a couple of years ago as part of our UNESCO 6 exhibition because the collection was recognised as a nationally significant collection. The material that these men, and they were mostly men, that they produced was they produced their own newspapers in their own languages, and they seemed to set up businesses in the camps. They even created a theatre and produced sort of theatre bills and handbills, and obviously they really believed that they, you know, in order to get through this terrible experience of being interned, they kept themselves busy. I think there was a German term they use, which is, if I rest, I rust, obviously in the German. So as they, you know, were determined to keep themselves intellectually stimulated and busy in these intern camps. So in a sense, when you look at some of this material, you think, oh, that's very cultured, and obviously sounds quite lovely to establish a theatre and to devise costumes or, you know, with all these different social activities. But I'm imagining it was pretty grim. I mean, I guess particularly Holsworthy in winter been a very grim place. And were these internees, were they viewed as POWs? Were they viewed as prisoners, as criminals? What was their kind of legal status?
It's interesting. They are referred to as prisoners of war as well as internees. But in actual fact, what we would consider prisoners of war today, there was very few actual prisoners of war in the camps. And then I think they were viewed as criminals or as
enemies
that warranted being kind of kept behind barbed wire for the duration of the war. It was it was by no means a pleasant experience. I think the Holsworthy Liverpool camp was probably one of the better camps, which is not saying a lot. In terms of, there were very again, all of this, everything that happened in the camps was set in law. So there were rules and restrictions about how the camps were set up, even how many showers an intern could have per week, how they were set up. Camps, for example, on Brottnest Island, which just as we know and as is being increasingly discussed, has had such a devastating and shocking horrific history. And then on Torrens Island as well, there are some fantastic photographs. One of the internees was allowed to keep his camera, and this amazing Paul Dubosky, I believe his name is, and he was allowed to keep his camera, and it's beds in mud. It is shacks in mud. These were not humane places to live. And around 1915, they decided to close a lot of the state camps and bring the majority of the men. And it was, as you note, it was men. I think there were less than 200, less than 150 women or children who were interned during this period. They were all brought to New South Wales. And in the book, I talk about one of the men from South Australia, Wilhelm Karl Lude. And there's a quote that really stuck with me, that when it was announced in the South Australian Parliament that these men had been removed from Torrens Island, they were on the train to New South Wales, there were cheers within the South Australian Parliament in one of the houses of one of the chambers of Parliament as these enemies were gone, banished.
Amazing.
To New South Wales. Yeah.
Well, and talking about banished, so can you touch briefly on what happened to these people at the end of the war?
Yeah, it's so at the end of the war, you have these kind of 6,000 to 7,000 men who had been locked together for this long period of time without any, you know, little to do, not a lot of work, those types of things. What do you do with them? So there was a committee on aliens who said, look, we really need to get them out of the country. We've put together all these people who normally wouldn't be together. They're all really unhappy. We need to do something about this. So between about May 1919 and through 1920, so it's also important to note that this was the period of the Spanish, the influenza pandemic. Mm-hmm. So they're trying to get people out of the country at this time, and then the influenza pandemic is just making everything more complicated. So between this period of about a year, 13 months, there's this mass exodus of individuals, about 5,000 to 6,000 individuals, mostly men. And I say mass exodus because the term repatriation was used and the term deportation was used. Now, in the vast majority of cases, though, the men voluntarily chose to leave because they were given the option of you're going to be deported or you can choose to leave. So they could legally be deported under the Aliens Restrictions Order, but the majority of these men just simply chose to leave the country. That caused some problems later on, though. So after the war, we've kind of got rid of a bunch of these men who were interned. We've got rid of these enemy aliens. We're looking forward, Australia looking forward to the country it wants to be. We're putting in more restrictions around who can be naturalized, who can become a member of our community. The trouble was, because of the fact that many of these men hadn't been legally deported, they could come back. And in I talk about one of the men in, I mentioned Karl Lude beforehand. He was one of those individuals. He threatened a police officer with a gun at the start of the war. He was interned for the majority of the war. But he was a real character. He jumped ship when he was being, repatriated. He came back to be with his wife and family, and he was naturalized in, I believe, the late 1920s. And that's when the government realized that if he hadn't legally deported these men, then they could actually come back. And so that caused some immigration issues later on in that 1920s period.
Yeah. That's so fascinating, you know, the determination and stubbornness of an individual. That's a nice ending, isn't it, really, to be able to be reunited with your family.
Yeah, they settled in Queensland, and he and his wife had a child at the start of the war. They had three kids, and he settled into the community as a butcher. And it is, he's an absolute character. Really enjoyed his story. I mean, apart from the threatening and the gun and the don't do that. No.
And interesting, I didn't realise this, that it was actually in 1999 that the then Governor General William Dean actually publicly apologised to the German Australian community. Isn't that fascinating? I did not know about that.
And for me, I was reflecting on this as well. The fact it was interesting that, I mean, I think it's very significant that the Governor General who did this was actually a former Justice of the High Court as well. I talk a lot about the kind of the very hands-off approach that the High Court took to the legislation or to overturning the legislation. They gave the government and parliament a very broad brush with what they could do during this time. And so to have that apology made, not only to members of the German and Australian community, but more generally by a former Justice of the High Court, I think was very significant.
Now, I wanted to make sure that we touched on some of the other people that you look at in the book. It's not, you don't just look at internees, you don't just look at these enemy alien people, you actually are looking at other Australians who are impacted and affected by this legislation. If we could look at two women activists, you talk about Jenny Baines and Adela Pankhurst, one of the famous Pankhurst women. They were getting into more and more trouble as the war progressed, sounds like. Protesting on the streets of Melbourne. Can you talk about what they were motivated by and what were these women doing to aggravate police and politicians, these troublesome women?
It's such a funny story that at the start of World War One we had these two famous British suffragettes walking the streets of Melbourne. They'd come out to Australia individually in early 1914. Adela notably had fallen out with her mother, Emmeline Pankhurst, and so she had migrated to Australia.
And, a long way to go.
across the other side of the world. And then Jenny Baines actually had immigrated with her family because she was facing charges in Manchester about due to a railway bombing. So we ended up at the start of the First World War with these two famous British suffragettes, both who'd used military tactics, hunger strikes, to engage in what they were seeking to achieve. And both of them, they were very outspoken from the start of the war. They joined with Vita Goldstein. They worked on her election campaign in 1914 for that September 1914 election, federal election that I mentioned. And then they worked with Vita Goldstein as part of her Women's Political Association, and then with the forming of the Women's Peace Army as well. Now, at this stage, 1915, 1916, both women were very vocal. They were giving a lot of speeches. They were publishing a lot of anti-war articles. Mm-hmm. But they were under surveillance. So the police even though they had by this time done a lot that very likely breached the law, they hadn't been arrested yet, but they were under surveillance. And there was kind of two reasons why the government was very hesitant to actually arrest them. And this was, Billy Hughes actually wrote a letter to Keith Murdoch saying, like, I don't know what to do about these women. On the one hand, arresting them would give them attention so that their arrests would be published and they would get more attention. And Billy Hughes also said, look, I also really don't want to arrest women. And these were like tiny little women. Like I talk in the book, I talk about the fact they were both under 5 feet. Jenny Baines was about 50. Adela Pankhurst was about 32 in 1917. But that was the year that everything really changed. They'd been obviously very active with the no vote for the conscription referendum in 1916. But then in 1917, despite efforts made previously by the government around shortages of goods, particularly food, there were major shortages in 1917. And so they were really, they took to the streets very publicly in Melbourne to get attention to the price of food and the shortages of food in the community. And so they started this around mid-August 1917, and this was the first time that they were arrested. They would congregate in large groups, and I'm talking 2,000, 3,000 people. They would congregate in large groups around Parliament House in Melbourne and demand to talk to Billy Hughes or another member of government. As this continued, the government created a new regulation that actually made it an offence to congregate in groups of 20 or more around Parliament House. And it was on, if you did this on the pretext of making grievances known or to make grievances known, you could be arrested. And Jenny Baines, Adela Pankhurst, and their fellow comrade, Alice Souter, were arrested under this provision. They were arrested, they were prosecuted, they were going to be sent to jail for a number of months, but they appealed to the High Court and they were successful. And they were successful on a technicality. They were charged under the wrong provision. They were charged on the basis that they had been there on a pretext, and they hadn't been there on the pretext. It was very clear that they were there protesting food prices. So they got mass jubilation in left-wing socialist newspapers that these women had beat Hughes, had beat the system. But obviously they're not going to behave themselves for long. So then in this same period, August, September 1917, the Unlawful Associations Act had been passed the previous year. And one of the provisions of that act made it an offence to incite violence, destruction of property, endanger human life. Adela Pankhurst makes a number of speeches in Melbourne in kind of mid to late September. On the occasion of one of these speeches, on the 19th of September, after she makes this speech, she and about 2,000 people go to Parliament House. Another few people run around the streets of Melbourne destroying windows. The next night, she makes a speech about this, discussing what happened, and she is arrested and prosecuted for that speech. And she goes to the High Court. They say, no, you incited and damaged a property where this is a constitutional provision. You're going to jail. And she goes to jail for about 2 months of a 4 month period. She's released by Hughes on the basis of public campaigns to release her. And there's this wonderful story that people would come outside and go outside the jail in Melbourne and would actually sing to keep her spirits up. And people were then arrested and prosecuted for singing to Adela Pankhurst while she was in jail. And so at this period, around this period, there's this kind of transition. Things become a lot quieter for Pankhurst. She's married by this time. She falls pregnant. And then things really pick up for Jenny Baines. So both Pankhurst and Baines were socialists. Pankhurst less so in 1918, but things really pick up for Jenny Baines. It becomes an offence to fly the red flag. Okay, the socialist emblem of the red flag. So Jenny Baines goes and does it on a daily basis. And she keeps getting arrested for it.
Because of course, the Russian Revolution would be happening.
The last thing you want people doing in 1918 Australia is running around waving the red flag. So of course that's like a red flag to a bull. She doesn't stay. And so she's arrested a number of times over the 1918 to 1919 period. And one of the really important things to note here is that particularly with socialist left-wing organisations in Australia, they would not pay fines. They would not give money to the government. So they would take the jail time instead. What Jenny Baines would do is she would take the jail time before she would go to jail. She would run, she would drink a glass of milk, and then she would hunger strike in prison. She did this a couple of times, and it's noted, I think, in Woman Voter, the Vita Goldstein newspaper, that she was the first woman in Australia to do this, or the first person in Australia to engage in a hunger strike. The authorities thought she will break. We'll put some lamb outside her door. She will break. She did not break. They released her because they were so worried about what would happen to her.
So how long was she in?
She wasn't even in that long. Right. She, after about 4 days, I think they were like,
shut it down.
We're just going to let her out. So she, these women were such, they were driven by their values and their belief. There are letters where Adela Pankhurst talks about her belief in the rule of law and liberty, and they were driven by their values, their commitment to justice and to a better society. They had come from Britain. They had all these tactics up their sleeves, and they did not believe in the war, and they were willing to do what it took to move forward with their anti-war effort.
And obviously had generated a lot of support, you know, 2,000 to 3,000 people protesting during that time.
Yeah.
So we're getting on to past one. So I've got my final question ready to go. But if people have got questions they want to now share, they could start typing their questions and get ready, and we'll respond after this last little segment. Catherine, in your conclusion, which is fascinating, you touch on the fact, or you really sort of conclude by saying that it took a long time for some of these laws to actually be repealed. It wasn't as though the armistice was signed in 1918 and then this legislation was cancelled, repealed. It took a long time for aspects of it. And even today, this blew my mind, there are still parts of legislation that are current today that came in and were part of the World War One experience. So can you sort of very briefly touch some examples of our legislation that goes
into that? So really good point. Well, I mean, the most famous example is regulation of the word Anzac. So that came into effect immediately in 1921, and it's the same legislation used in 1921 that is in effect today that bans the use of Anzac or prohibits the use of Anzac without permission on a house or in business, commercial use, etc. More generally, though, we've seen, and there have been some changes over time, but provisions around sedition, for example, the inclusion of sedition in the Crimes Act, that they've been removed and replaced over time, but certainly around anti-terrorism offences, they have maintained a place. So that aspect of sedition, protests. Almost immediately after the war finished, we reintroduced all those provisions around protests and gatherings, and even aspects, for example, around deportation. So under the Migration Act, an individual who is, even though they may have lived in this country for years, and we've seen a number of high profile instances of this, individuals who've lived in this country for years, they have committed a crime, received a jail term of say 2 years, and then they can legally be deported. So there are a whole range of provisions that are either identical to or inspired by provisions that came from this World War, this First World War, Great War legislation and regulations.
And yeah, it seemed like you were saying, particularly after 9/11, there was...
Where you had that similar period of significant legislative reaction to these events and the role that law could play in that war, the war on terror, as it's been known since.
Excellent. Fascinating. Many other questions I had, but we'll see if there's any questions from our audience. So Sam, hello.
Hello. Hello, I'm back. Thank you so much, Catherine. That was fascinating.
Thank you.
That was great. There's a bit of background noise here, so I might be just muting on and off a bit. I've got a couple of questions for you. First one is, what union opposition was there to the War Measures Act?
So it's very interesting because obviously the Labor Party was connected with the unions. And on the one hand, there was general support from the unions for the Labor Party and during the course of the war. But this began to change as the war progressed. And there's actually a fantastic new book by Liam Burnout, which talks about James Scullin and John Curtin and their experiences with the unions and this period actually during the war. So look, While there was that kind of initial bipartisan support, as there was kind of across the board, as the war progressed, many unions did become increasingly dissatisfied with the measures that were being put in place, as was the case across the community. But at the same time, unions were very anti, even though union members may have been of any enemy origin, there was also that feeling of this enemy in the community and wishing to and wanting to kind of control this enemy within the community. So those kind of ideas, those union ideals of solidarity, etc., did kind of fall by the wayside as well.
Question here asking, were women interned and repatriated as well?
So women often, I'm not aware of any individual women who were interned because of something that they had done. More often than not, women would go to internment camps on account of their husbands. So women and children, some camps would allow women and children to go to the camp with their husbands. I don't believe that Liverpool was simply not set up to accommodate women and children, as I understand it. But certainly women, there were less than about 150 women and children who were ultimately then interned. And women were often encouraged to follow their husbands to leave the country. So I talk about Carl Lude in the book, and his wife was Australian born in South Australia, and the local authorities really encouraged her to leave the country with her husband and her child. She had a 5-year-old daughter by the time Lude was being repatriated. And there's a really devastating letter in the book where she says, I don't want to leave. I was born here. I will die here. But then this family is split. And so women were encouraged, though, to continue. If their husband were German, they were encouraged to go with their husbands.
So fascinating. And I found the discussion about the suffragette women coming to Australia, that's great. Like history completes into like great.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's so fascinating.
Yeah.
I think that's all we've got for today. So I think really it falls to me in this situation to thank you both. Thank you, Elise, as usual, Sterling.
Thank you.
Pleasure to work with. And Catherine, thank you so much for joining us. I'd just like
thank you.
To know that Catherine's book is available online from the library bookshop. So if you would like to, there it is, Lauren, if you would like to jump onto the library bookshop website, you can order it and have it sent to you. You don't have to leave your house. Mind you, excuse to leave your house. But yeah, do go onto the library bookshop and order a copy for yourself. Thank you both so much.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
For joining
Thank
us.
You.
And we'll see everyone soon. See you later.
Thanks. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.